welcome to KT Connect's Knowledge Translation webinar series, co-hosted by Arthritis Research Canada and Michael Smith Health Research BC. My name is Ellen, and I will serve as your moderator for today. The webinar will consist of a 45-minute presentation followed by a 10 to 15-minute Q&A period. Before we begin, I do have a few housekeeping items to mention. First, all participants are muted. Please use the question box for questions that will be answered at the end and the chat box to post comments during the webinar. If you experience any connection issues, please use the link provided on screen. This webinar will be recorded and shared on the Michael Smith Health Research BC website. Please reshare. If you're active on social media, continue the discussion online using the hashtag KTConnects. And while we meet on a virtual platform, I would like all of us to take a moment to honor the land on which we gather. Both Arthritis Research Canada and Michael Smith Health Research BC are located on the traditional unceded territory of the Coast Salish peoples, namely the territories of the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh Nations. We are grateful to have participants joining us from across the country and across the world. From coast to coast to coast, we acknowledge the ancestral and unceded territory of all the Inuit, Métis, and First Nations people that have called this land home for many generations. Now, join me in welcoming our three guest speakers for today. Dr. Lindsay Nettlefold, Senior Scientist with Active Aging Research Team at the University of British Columbia. Dr. Sarah Munro, Assistant Professor in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at the University of British Columbia, as well as Knowledge Translation Program Head at the Center for Health Evaluation and Outcome Science. And Dr. Sonia Singh, Hospital List Physician and Osteoporosis Consultant at the Peace Arch Hospital. And with that, we now have our learning objectives. Number one, we hope today you will be able to define implementation science and relevant terms. Secondly, to describe theories, models, and frameworks used to implement, scale, and evaluate clinical interventions. And finally, the goal will be to present two case studies to actually illustrate some the process and some examples. Now, with that, I will turn it over to Lindsay.
Thanks, Ellen. I'm just going to share my screen. Okay, wonderful. Okay, so my name is Lindsay Nettlefold. I'm here from the Active Aging Research Team, which is co-led by Drs. Heather McKay and Dr. Johnny Simschool from the University of British Columbia. And our team spends a lot of time in implementation and scale-up science. And so I've been asked to come here today and provide a brief introduction, including some key terminology before we hear from Dr. Munro and Dr. Singh about their real-world examples of implementation science in action. So before we dive in, I would also like to acknowledge and gratefully joining today from the traditional territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. And so now we're at a KT Connect webinar. Many or all of you probably know that there's a gap between what we know from research settings and what is used in practice. And this is commonly referred to as the research to practice or the no-do gap. And there is a statistic that often accompanies the statement that it takes on average 17 years for just 14% of research to make it from research into practice. And I'm not going to spend any time here. There is a whole KT Connects webinar devoted to the 17-year gap. But suffice to say that what is known from research is often not what is adopted in practice. Now, there's a second gap illustrated here on the screen on the right side, and this is where our team is living right now. And we refer to this second gap as the implementation gap or the implementation to scale up gap. And what this is referring to is that often interventions that we know to be effective from research studies are not delivered as intended, they're not delivered at scale, and they're not sustainable. And these three factors taken together means that the interventions that we know were effective in controlled research studies are not able to yield wide-reaching benefits at the population level. And so this is reflecting really that there tends to be far more resources invested in discovery than there is in moving things into practice, implementing them well, and then scaling them up to reach more individuals. So I'm going to define some of these key terms now. So on the previous slide, I used the word implementation, and the definition that we use is that it is a process of putting to use an evidence-based intervention within a particular setting. And the other term that you heard was scale-up, and scale-up is also a process where we expand delivery of an evidence-based intervention in the real world so that we can benefit more people on a lasting basis. And finally, implementation science is a way to bridge the gaps that we heard between research, practice, and broad-scale outcomes. So implementation science is the scientific study of methods used to promote the systematic uptake of research findings into routine practice so that we can improve the quality and effectiveness of health service. And I just tag on health promotion there because that's the field that I live in. So just to summarize those three definitions, we have implementation and scale up, which are the processes. And then we have implementation science, which is the scientific study of those methods that we use in the processes. Now, you'll have noticed in the definitions previously that they explicitly stated we want to implement and scale up evidence-based interventions. But I want to flag here that regardless of how valuable or effective your intervention is, they do not implement themselves. And it's really important to remember here that we have two things. So first, we have the innovation itself. And I use the word innovation to reflect it can be an intervention, it could be a policy, or it could be a practice. But alongside that, we also have the implementation approach. So how is it being implemented in the setting? And these are the implementation strategies that we use to support delivery. So reminder, there's two things here. We have an innovation and we have an implementation approach. So implementation strategies are the specific methods or techniques that we use to enhance the adoption, implementation, and sustainability of an innovation. I'm going to illustrate this with a couple of examples on the next slide. So one of the challenges with implementation science, like many fields that have had, you know, fairly rapid growth, there's lots of adjacent fields, is in language. And on the previous slides, I gave you the definitions that we use, which are from the literature, and they're a little bit jargony and it can be a little bit of a barrier sometimes when you're orienting yourself to the field. So I'm going to share here a slide that Jeffrey Curran uses. Jeffrey Curran is a well-established implementation scientist, does a lot of teaching, and he actually published this slide that he uses, which is in plain language, and he uses this when he teaches and introduces implementation science. So I hope that this will be helpful in clarifying some of those words. So the innovation, which again is the policy, the practice, or the intervention, is the thing. Then we can do effectiveness research, which looks at whether the thing works. Implementation research looks at how do we help people or places do the thing. And implementation strategies are all the things we do to try and help people and places do the thing. So I'm going to just give you an example from our work. We are implementing and scaling up a physical activity intervention for older adults. It's called Choose to Move. And so in our case, Choose to Move is our thing. That's the thing that we are trying to implement. We collect data, effectiveness data, to determine whether or not Choose to Move is working. And so in our case, that's, is it increasing physical activity and mobility in our participants? Our implementation research is trying to understand how can we help our delivery partners to deliver Choose to Move? And then our implementation strategies are all the things that we or our support system are doing to help our partners deliver Choose to Move. So we have a lot of implementation strategies that we use. The examples that I've pulled out here are training. So we offer training to all the organizational staff. We provide them resources to help with delivery. And then we provide ongoing support and consultation with them as needed to troubleshoot any issues that they're having with program delivery. So where does implementation research fit in sort of this landscape of research we're talking about? So once you have an intervention or a practice of interest, the first question we ask is, do we have evidence that it works? Do we have efficacy? Does it work in a controlled research setting? And if the answer is no, then the first step is to do an efficacy trial. And you'll note here that the authors of this particular image have flagged underneath their design for implementation. And this is the way that we speak about this is begin with the end in mind. And I think that's from the World Health Organization's. So when we're testing innovations in efficacy trials, they should be innovations that are realistic to deliver in a real world setting. So being mindful right from the start about the potential time or resource constraints in your intended setting. The next question you ask is whether there's evidence of effectiveness. So does it work in a real world setting? And here there's a few different paths that come up. So if you don't have any effectiveness data, you can study that, right? That's the upper line, the light blue line there. You can also do what's called a hybrid effectiveness implementation trial. And these trials emerged as a way to try and accelerate the research process. And these trials have two aims. They have an implementation research aim and an effectiveness research aim. And depending on sort of like the state of your study or your data or where you're at, either the effectiveness or the implementation can be the primary aim. And in some cases, you can have them as co-primary aims. So one of the advantages of collecting both effectiveness and implementation data concurrently is that we can use the implementation data to help interpret our effectiveness outcomes. So as an example, in my PhD, I was evaluating scale-up of a school-based intervention called Action Schools BC. And I came in to the study after there was good evidence of efficacy. They had already done an efficacy trial. And I just want to offer huge kudos here to Heather McKay and PJ Naylor, who were the PIs on that project, for doing a hybrid trial before that language even existed. So in cases where our effectiveness data wasn't what we expected based on the efficacy trial results, we were able to use the implementation data to help explain. So we looked at it and say, okay, well, the dose that was delivered was lower in the effectiveness trial. So then that can potentially explain why the outcomes were also a little bit lower. So to put it another way, when we collect implementation data, it helps us untangle whether the intervention didn't work or whether the intervention wasn't implemented as expected. And knowing which of these two factors it is can allow you to go back to the drawing board and figure out, do we need to make tweaks to our intervention or do we need to make tweaks to our implementation approach? So that's kind of the middle line there. And then at the bottom here, if you have evidence of effectiveness, you can move right along to the bottom path and you can start looking at more focused implementation research around context. You can work to design implementation strategies or test implementation strategies specifically. Now I was asked to briefly touch on theories, models, and frameworks. And kind of the short answer here is there's a lot of different approaches that are used in implementation science. Roughly, they can be broken down into three broad categories. So starting on the left here in blue, we have process models, which are used to guide the implementation process. So examples here that you might be familiar with are like knowledge to action or getting to outcomes. In the purple in the middle, we have determinant frameworks, and these are ones that help us understand the contextual factors that influence implementation. So a commonly used one in our field is the CIFR, which stands for the Consolidated Framework for Implementation Research. In our work, we use one called the Framework for Effective Implementation. And then finally, in the green on the right-hand side, there are frameworks that guide evaluation. So they offer some suggestions and guidance on what should we be measuring in implementation research? What are our outcomes? Now, I've put up here, I pulled from our work a couple of examples to illustrate the determinant and the evaluation framework. So this is a simplified version of the determinant framework that we use. But really, there are so many similarities across frameworks. And when it comes down to it, everybody has this innovation, whether it's a policy, a practice, or a program. And it's at the center, and it's surrounded by these layers of context. And in here, you know, these are all the things that have the potential to influence implementation of the innovation. So the example here is we have our innovation, choose to move at the center, and then there are characteristics of the innovation itself that are going to influence implementation. So is it a good match for the organization, for the setting? Is it appropriate for the population and their, you know, the mission of the organization? There's also characteristics of the providers. So do the providers have the skills needed? Is it a priority for their organization? You know, those are all going to influence on how well the program is implemented. And then at the very outside there, we have community factors. And so what's the state of funding or what's the political landscape look like that are related to your innovation? All of those things can influence how a program is implemented in a setting. Now, I don't have time to go into this today, but I'm putting it up as a resource in case it's relevant or helpful for anyone. If you're doing any implementation research and looking at wondering what kind of things you should be evaluating. So we published this a couple of years ago now, and we used a Delphi process to identify and create a minimum data set of implementation indicators. And this minimum data set includes 10 implementation determinants. So the determinants, like the determinant frameworks, these are the range of contextual factors that influence implementation and scale up. So examples of these are like the feasibility of your intervention or the organizational culture or the cost of the intervention. And then there's five implementation outcomes, which are defined as the results of an implementation effort. And so these are things like reach, dose delivered, fidelity, those kinds of things. So we use this minimum data set to guide our evaluation planning for our implementation science grants. It's been a really helpful framework to make sure that we're assessing all the things that we need to understand what's happening and why, and then use that for improvement as well. So I'm going to stop here. And if I can sum up just a key takeaway message, you know, beyond the definitions and the theories, is that implementation really does matter. And that is reflecting both supporting implementation and also evaluating it. Collectively across, you know, health research, we have a lot of interventions at work, and we generally do a good job of evaluating interventions, but we don't do as good a job of understanding implementation, how we can best support it, how to evaluate it, and its relationship to outcomes. So thank you so much for joining us today. I've popped my email up on the screen here. I'm happy to connect after the webinar if there's any further questions beyond what we get to in the Q&A session today.
Thank you so much, Lindsay. I'm so delighted to be following up your talk because it's a really nice practical case example of the principles that Lindsay shared there. Okay. And so thank you everyone who's here joining today. My name is Sarah Munro, and I am a scientist with the Center for Health Evaluation and Outcome Sciences and assistant professor at UBC. And I also run the Knowledge Translation Program at CAOS. And I'm gonna present to you today a project that's really close to my heart. I don't have many opportunities to present this anymore, but when we were talking about case examples, this was the first one that came to mind for me. It's called Right For Me, and it's a hybrid effectiveness implementation trial that I conducted a number of years back in partnership with the Dartmouth Institute for Health Policy and Clinical Practice. I just want to note first that there are a number of disclosures that I need to declare, including the funding we received from PCORI for this trial, but the funders play no role in the results or interpretation that I'm going to share with you today. So some context for this particular study. Shared decision making is a field of work that I've been involved in for many years, and I consider it a field of knowledge translation, of bringing together best evidence from clinical experts and the lived experience and values of patients to together make informed choices that are based on both the evidence and what matters most to patients. In the context of contraception, as you can imagine, there are many different methods available, and we consider it to be a preference-sensitive decision. The choice for method of contraception really depends on the features of the method that matter most to the person who's making that choice, depending on their reproductive goals, where they are at their life stage and their reproductive journey, whether they're trying to prevent a pregnancy or if they're planning and spacing. These are all different factors that go into choices. And shared decision-making is an approach that can support those choices. Patient decision aids are knowledge translation tools that support shared decision-making. So through this process of making a deliberative decision, decision aids help to state that a decision needs to be considered. They help to provide evidence-based information, and they also help patients to clarify and communicate what matters most to them. Patient decision aids are highly effective interventions. So going back to what Lindsay introduced there about the thing of study, patient decision aids are a tool that have been shown to be highly efficacious and effective in a range of different settings. As a knowledge translation tool, they lead to higher knowledge in patients and users, reductions in the decisional conflict that they may experience, readiness to make a decision, more accurate risk perceptions, more active participation in decision-making. And importantly, because these choices are preference sensitive, decision aids help patients to choose options that are a better match between their values and their choices. So in the Right For Me trial, we knew that there was really strong evidence available on the effectiveness of decision aids, but no contraceptive shared decision-making tools had been tested in a large trial to date. So we wanted to know, do these tools work to support shared decision-making for contraceptive choices?
And second, we wanted to know about implementation. In what contexts and circumstances will these tools be effective? So Right for Me was a hybrid trial type 2 design, and you can learn more about hybrid effectiveness implementation designs by checking out Curran's 2012 publication. And we had two primary questions. First, a question about effectiveness. Will the intervention, these shared decision-making tools, work in a given setting? And then our implementation question. Do the strategies or methods we use to get these tools into practice help to use the intervention as intended? In this class, there were 16 primary care and family planning clinics, and we allocated 4 clinics to each arm of the trial. The first focused on use of a shared decision-making video and prompt card. The second, these paper-based decision aids and some training for healthcare providers on how to use them. Arm 3 involved all of the interventions, and then arm 4 was usual care. I want to show you here what the tools looked like. So up here in the top left, this is the prompt card. It was for patients to view before they went into their healthcare encounter, and it aimed to enhance patients' motivation and skills and preparedness to ask clinical staff these 3 questions. What are my options? What are the possible pros and cons of the options? How likely are these pros and cons to happen to me? We also developed a video in both English and Spanish that showed patients how to use the prompt card and how to ask these questions. The second set of interventions were these paper-based decision aids that were in this option grid format. We had 7 one-page decision aids on contraceptive methods, and these were meant to be interactive for staff and patients to use in a clinical encounter. So whereas the video and prompt card were meant to prepare patients, these decision aids were meant to be used together in a healthcare visit. We also had an implementation strategy that supported the use of these decision aids with fidelity. It was a 5-minute training video, and then we also had written guidance in a PowerPoint presentation in our website that showed staff how to use the decision aids, and folks were meant to review those tools before we implemented them. So I'm going to show here my version of the current one slide and show you how our study mapped onto this terminology. So first of all, the interventions that we studied, or the innovations, were these tools here. We weren't looking at contraceptive method, importantly. So again, the intervention was not the actual clinical contraception. It was the intervention that supported people to make choices. Our effectiveness question: do the tools improve shared decision making? And our implementation question was, what helps people to use these tools in practice? Now, the strategies that we used to support the implementation of these tools were really minimal, and this was also intentional here. So we had the educational materials to support the paper-based decision aids to be used as intended. We had champions in each clinic site that were there to train people in how to do the trial, but also to get people oriented. But we wanted there to be a really clear sense for staff that they could adapt these tools into routine workflow however they wanted. And so our implementation study really sought not just to look at the effective strategies, but was it effective for us to use such an adaptable and flexible implementation approach, a very hands-off implementation approach for shared decision-making? And we grouped our implementation outcomes into these 3 areas: acceptability, feasibility, and the sustainability of the tools. I'm going to show you here the effectiveness and implementation outcomes. So again, looking at first, do the tools work to improve shared decision-making? And then our implementation question. And like I said, we were interested about the adaptability of our strategies. What strategies would clinics use in what circumstances and why? Throughout the evaluation or of the implementation approach, I used the theoretical domains framework, which is a determinant framework. It helps us to understand how organizations use new interventions in routine care and what helps and what hinders that uptake of new interventions. For the qualitative study, so this was answering the implementation question, I conducted interviews with clinical and administrative staff in one of the intervention arm clinics. So I was interested in understanding, you know, for folks who were medical office assistants and volunteers, people who were tasked with putting the implementation strategies out there, what was their experience of implementation? Not just looking at the clinicians who were to be involved in the shared decision-making itself. And that was really helpful for us to understand how the full context and the complexity of the clinic worked. I'm going to highlight here some of our key takeaways and then share some of the qualitative data. So first, what was really key was for primarily people had to be aware that these interventions were available in their clinics, and they had to know how to use them correctly. In a number of clinics where we saw evidence of low effect of the tools on shared decision-making in comparison to usual care, administrators were not aware of the tools and didn't make them freely available in a routine way. So for instance, in one clinic, the tablets that we provided for people to watch the videos in the waiting room, the clinic administrators were concerned about them being stolen. And so they kept them locked and handed them out with the patient having to provide a piece of ID or something in exchange for holding onto that tablet, which was really prohibitive. It didn't mean that people used it regularly. It also required an extra step for administrative staff that they didn't have the time to engage in. The next piece was around workflow and time and physical space. Being aware of the interventions, that also meant that the prompt cards were not always placed out each day as cleaning staff were going around and cleaning up a waiting area. It meant replacing the prompt cards, and the cleaning staff were not aware of how these tools are meant to be used or why. For the patient decision aids, which were paper-based, it was much easier to weave into routine care. These were to be used in the actual clinic room and meant to be used interactively. A couple of clinics that focus on sexual and reproductive health actually took the tools and put them in clear folders and affixed them to the wall so that they were easy to pull. A Planned Parenthood clinic took the tools and integrated them in with their binders that had all of their other sexual health resources. And so the weaving in of the tools into routine workflow made it so that it was just another easy part of the steps that they were already engaged in for making choices around contraception. And then finally, what was really interesting, and again, had an impact on our effectiveness outcomes, was this concept of motivation. People who were using the paper decision aid, so mostly clinic staff, found that they were able to observe the effect of those tools in their patients. They discussed options together, learned what matters most to patients, and then were able to see how the tool influenced their choice of method of contraception. Administrative staff did not see if there was any positive effect of using the tablet video and the prompt cards in a clinical encounter. They were not involved in those discussions. They weren't involved in shared decision-making. So it was really difficult for them to see in the context of the trial if those shared decision-making tools had a positive impact on the patient experience. And so in sum, what we learned through these factors, participants who were involved in the trial perceived that the decision aids were more acceptable, feasible, and sustainable than the video and the prompt cards. I'm going to point out here one of the things that I mentioned about adopting these tools into routine practice. As this participant said in Clinic 5, where they were unable to adopt the video and prompt card with fidelity, they note, I think the biggest challenge is just changing the behavior of the people who are interacting with patients to incorporate one more thing. And they go on to say, there's a lot of things that we're always asked to remember, to screen for depression, screen for this and look for that and do all these things. And so to have one more thing to sort of hand them, everybody out there sort of wants you to hand patients one more thing. And that's the most challenging part, is sort of triaging those and changing practice. Like I said, we all sort of get into our routines. And so to try to remember a new thing is hard. Another key thing that I think one of the limitations of our study is we didn't interview patients, which I really wish we had done. It wasn't a decision that I was a part of because I came into the study a bit later, but participants talked about the social influence of patients on the process of using the interventions. So from the same clinic, this participant said, I'd say the majority of patients that come into the waiting room are on their own phones and computers and are not really looking around. And they go on to say, we have a TV, we have a lot of educational things about just general health, and I feel like the patients are not tuned into that because they're just on their phone or on their computer or reading their books. And so what I hope you glean as some key takeaways is that this implementation study nested in the trial provided critical information on what worked for whom and in what context regarding implementing the shared decision-making tools. The data from the qualitative study helped us to identify that the video and prompt card need more structured implementation. For instance, Clinic 5 said that in future, they would want to include the video and 3 questions in the email appointment reminder that they sent to patients and to prompt them to watch it before their visit. The next piece was really that paper-based decision aids fit into the norms of routine workflow for contraception decision-making. Planned Parenthood brought these tools into their binders for routine use, and they were intending to use them in their national resources after the end of the trial. And so I hope that you can agree that trial designers should be considering using hybrid designs as a strategy to accelerate implementation and understand what are the factors that are going to make innovation stick in routine care. If you're curious to learn more about the study, you can find my paper here in Implementation Science from 2019. I want to acknowledge the many different folks who were involved in this work, including principal investigator Rachel Thompson, and point out some future work that we're doing here in BC. We're anticipating, hopefully, an announcement of free prescription contraception for all, which is part of Minister Dix's mandate letter. And so my team is looking at how we can support shared decision-making in this context, focusing on the perspectives of youth. You can find me on Twitter at Dr. Sarah Munro, and I look forward to your questions later on in our session.
Great. Thank you for passing on to me, Sarah, and presenting just a fantastic example of a completed implementation science project. I'm just going to get my slides up and going. Sorry for the delay. And I just wanted to thank everyone who's on the webinar for joining us today. And I'm really excited to be able to share an example of our team's use of implementation science methods to navigate the road to implementation of a new fracture prevention program. So I wanted to have my disclosure that I am no expert to implementation science. This is my first implementation science project, and I still have a lot of questions how best to use implementation science in projects. And I thought I would start by giving you a little bit of an example of how I got started in the whole field of implementation science. It all started in my work as an emergency room physician, and I knew that we took really good care of patients who came in with fractures, especially older adults. But over time, I started to ask myself why we weren't doing anything to prevent them from coming back with that second and third fracture. And they did come back. So quite some time ago, I was made aware of a new program called Fracture Liaison Services, or FLS. And this program or model of care for secondary fracture prevention involved having a dedicated FLS coordinator working directly with the orthopedic staff, either in the outpatient clinics or on the wards in the hospital. And that coordinator did 3 very important things. First of all, screening and identifying those patients that had had a low trauma or fragility fracture, initiating the appropriate investigations to assess their risk of having repeat fractures and falls, and finally, initiating a personalized treatment plan for them, which always included some education and also included potential osteoporosis medications and referrals to things like falls prevention, osteoporosis specialists, and exercise programs in the community as appropriate. And throughout this whole process, sorry, I don't seem to be able to advance my slides. Communication with the primary care providers in the community. And over time, there has been increasing global evidence that this type of fracture prevention program reduces refracture rates and mortality rates quite significantly. So in 2015, there were no FLS programs in British Columbia. And once I had learned about this program, I came back to BC and started implementing the first FLS at Peace Arch Hospital. We got it going in 2015. We did a before and after study and found similar results as had been reported internationally. It really did work in the BC context. And with the really positive results that we had at Peace Arch, our executive director decided to fund the program permanently after our research funding ran out. So that was great. We had implemented FLS at one hospital for one community, but what about the rest of British Columbia? So in 2018, it just so happened that Michael Smith started their first implementation science team grant competition, and our Fraser Health grant facilitator arm-twisted me into applying for this grant. And to my surprise, we were successful in getting the grant. And so our new research question was focused on how can an evidence-based FLS model that was implemented at one hospital be successfully scaled up to other sites within Fraser Health to improve informed spread across our entire province. So we had three key questions. So first of all, we wanted to know what strategies work best to successfully implement FLS. Why are these strategies successful? How can they be adapted to suit different settings? And we used some of the frameworks that Lindsay talked about in her presentation. So first of all, the CFER, the Consolidated Framework for Implementation Research. And for our evaluation framework, we chose the REAIM, which stands for Reach, Effectiveness, Adoption, Implementation, and Maintenance. And these two frameworks for newbies in the field seemed quite quite easy to understand and easy to put into practice. So for those of you who are not familiar with CFER, it has five domains as listed at the top in the blue. And underneath each of those domains are specific constructs that we chose from the larger group of constructs from our previous experience implementing at Peace Arch. And then we used REAIM as our evaluation framework. We used a multiple case study design, and our first two objectives were to scale up FLS and identify effective implementation strategies that would work in different types of hospital settings. So we chose a tertiary care, a rural community hospital, and a suburban community hospital. We used mixed methods, incorporating all sources of data that we could access. And so this gives you a little bit of an idea of how we implemented at Chilliwack Hospital. These are all of our implementation activities that took place from February to December of 2021. And as you can see, it started with securing buy-in with the leadership at the site and went on eventually to hiring the FLS in the summer and starting up in December of 2021. So it took us actually less than a year to get things up and going. And throughout that time period, we were doing our research processes and data collection, which included key informant interviews with our key stakeholders, administrative data collection, patient journey mapping, and team journaling. The implementation piece of our study looked at using the REAIM evaluation, and we did this about 3 months after we had started the FLS program. So reach, who is our FLS reaching? Who is not being reached and why? Adoption, how many orthopedic clinics and how many wards have adopted FLS? And finally, implementation. So looking at the fidelity to set guidelines for FLS implementation, acceptability to patients, physicians, and staff using surveys and interviews. And then post-implementation, which we've done 6 to 9 months later, focused on effectiveness of our key performance indicators for FLS and of our implementation strategies. And finally, looking at maintenance. What strategies will help us keep the program going long-term? So we were successful in implementing at 2 of our 3 hospitals, but not at our tertiary care hospital. And so we have a lot of data collected. We haven't had a chance to analyze it all, but this is going to give us a rich source of data to do cross-case analysis to learn both from our successes as well as from our failures. Our third objective in the project was to understand long-term sustainability and impact of FLS at the Peace Arch Hospital site, where FLS had been running for some time. And we're following people for 18 months, looking at adherence and persistence with treatment recommendations, quality of life, and patient and provider experience. And throughout those 18 months, we're going to also be doing an economic analysis. And our final objective was to create an implementation strategy, learning from everything that we were doing at the other sites to spread FLS across the entire province. And in October of 2022, we partnered with Osteoporosis Canada to host a provincial forum. It was very well attended. We had 42 people there. It was great to have an event in person. And we had 4 out of the 5 regional health authorities represented, including 3 Ministry of Health representatives and 3 health authority administrators. And we're hoping that this will be a springboard to developing a provincial FLS strategy. So our project is still ongoing. We still have another year or plus to finish up everything, but I just wanted to share some of our key learnings. The first thing that I learned is how important it is to have a multidisciplinary team that crosses over all different sectors of society. And so it was vitally important that our team include people from the healthcare system itself, from academia, from policy, that we include patients with lived experience of osteoporosis, and that we had the funding to carry out this work. I'm really honored to have 2 fantastic co-leads on my team, and each one of us have a special role. So my role as a clinician embedded within the health authority, I have the linkages and connections to healthcare staff, administrators, and physicians. My co-lead Tanya Bubala, as Dean of Health Sciences at SFU, she provides that real strong grounding in academic research. And Larry Fennell, our patient partner, makes sure that we stay grounded in the patient perspective, because that's what our work is really all about. And the added benefit with Larry is that he used to be a government bureaucrat and so really understands healthcare policy. And finally, our executive sponsor, Linda Dempster from Fraser Health, made sure that we had all the resources of Fraser Health at our disposal. We have a fantastic broader research team. And in terms of our researchers, we have an implementation science expert, a knowledge translation expert, and a health economist. So important to have all this expertise when you're a fairly new researcher to implementation science like myself. We have an additional patient partner. And I just want to highlight our decision makers from the Ministry of Health and also the Executive Director, FLS Champion within Fraser Health. All of them have really helped us move things forward. And finally, how important it is to have excellent research coordinators. This is a big project with lots of moving parts. And so our 2 research coordinators keep us on track. The other thing that we learned is how valuable site implementation teams were. So these were at the individual hospital sites where we were implementing FLS for the first time. This allowed the teams at the sites to take ownership of FLS implementation. The staff really took pride in their new FLS program and expressed a lot of excitement at being part of the research. We tried to foster an atmosphere of partnership and support rather than have our research team telling them what to do. The other thing that became clear is that we needed to have clear messaging around what is FLS and what is implementation science. And so we've developed a YouTube video and a whiteboard video, and I've included the links if you're interested in watching any of them. And finally, local research that we had done at Peace Arch was published. That really was a strong facilitator. And the fact that we had developed an in-depth FLS toolkit that new sites could just take and adapt as needed for their individual site needs. So in summary, my experience with implementation science as a first-time implementation science researcher at times has been very frustrating. It was a lot more time-consuming than I had anticipated. It was messy, but it has been fun, it's been creative, and it has been so rewarding. And it's been a wonderful opportunity, I think, to make tangible change in the health system. So I'm going to stop here and hand back to Ellen.
Thank you so much for your presentations, Dr. Singh, Dr. Munro, Dr. Nettlefold. And with that, we're going to encourage everyone to use the Q&A function to submit your questions there. We do have a few that already came in, so I will start with those. And I'm going to welcome our speakers to go ahead and answer. Just jump in if you're feeling the call to answer the question. So our first question, it seems like implementation research is quite downstream from the initial establishment of efficacy. Does it make sense to build implementation design from the onset of a novel intervention, to say it's a randomized controlled trial, or to complete those initial stages and then develop an implementation research design based on what has emerged?
I'm curious to know what my colleagues think about this, but my position is very strongly that earlier is better. So when you consider implementation considerations early on, including at the efficacy stage, you can really get a better sense of potential downstream issues and potential roadblocks. And so it doesn't have to necessarily involve an implementation study like we've described so far. I would say implementation science is quite broad, and we've just touched on a few different methods through our case examples. So for instance, at the efficacy stage, I would encourage to include patient engagement to identify the acceptability of a new treatment, or integrated KT with regulators to understand what are the potential roadblocks for regulatory review and to accelerate that process. I also see there being a trend. Someone asked at the end, what do we see moving forward with implementation science in Canada? CIHR has really shifted its language to focus on knowledge mobilization, and that highlights the importance of upstream implementation science. So really taking a spectrum approach from end to end and making sure that implementation is considered throughout. Yeah, that's my perspective, though. I would love to hear how others feel about it.
Lindsay, Sonia, was that?
I would just I concur with Sarah there. I think in the, you know, that beginning with the end in mind, I think is really important to think about where you want to end up, what settings you want to end up, and those, you know, early needs assessments with your patients or your delivery partners, all of those things can feed into building a design right from the start that's going to work later on as well.
Thank you for that.
I guess I can say I completely agree with Lindsay and Sarah. I think from a clinician researcher perspective, I certainly found a lot of the implementation science hybrid models where they're looking at both effectiveness and implementation at the same time quite confusing. So again, you know, coming into it not as you know, a full-on implementation science researcher, I think that would have been a challenge. And the fact that our intervention had already been very well researched made it much easier for us to sort of move forward looking more at the implementation and the strategies that can support implementation. But I do agree with Sarah that that would be the way to develop interventions so that the implementation will be so much easier.
Thank you very much for that. And I will actually have a question directed at you. This question I think will be great because of your background as a clinician scientist. So on top of the actual strategies used to implement those evidence-based practices, this individual would like to know or understand, better understand some of the strategies and the timing for training personnel in preparation to make that implementation process a little bit smoother. So can you speak to maybe the importance of training personnel? How do you get buy-in of the clinicians, of the administration staff?
So I guess there's two things. One is buy-in of bringing the intervention to the site. And the other is buy-in for the actual implementation process. And I think that's what the question was. And I think that's where it was really important that I could provide those connections to the physicians, because since I did work as an emergency physician, I really did use a lot of my connections with the orthopedic surgeons, who I obviously worked quite closely with, and also using my connections with the administrative leads. Now, I think in other projects, if you're a researcher that is not embedded in the health system, then I think it's really important that you find those people that can do that networking and connection, because I think that made a huge difference. And then in terms of the actual implementation and the timing of different things, I mean, I think in that flow sheet I showed that we try to really quickly develop implementation teams at the site and make sure that they were healthcare providers working in the system, and our team provided the support they needed to move forward. So they wanted to move forward, they had the connections, they wanted to make it happen, and we supported them with the tools, such as the toolkit. We provided the training for the FLS coordinator, and we really, really firmed up that toolkit and helped them adapt it to their own context. So being respectful of their time, and then they could see the success of the project as it advanced. And so that was super reinforcing for the healthcare staff. So I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that. And our last question, what training or resources could you recommend for research teams who are starting out with their implementation science studies?
I was just responding to that live. I don't know if folks here are going to put in a plug for the upcoming work of different organizations around implementation science, but if you're a graduate student, you can always take my course. There's that too. Obstetrics 581, which is a KT and implementation science course, and Ellen is a part of it this semester.
Would recommend. But we will link a bunch of resources when this video is posted. And with that, we are going to welcome Lupin to join us.
Yeah, so taking Sarah's lead there to plug, I wanted to mention that with Jen Creighton, who is at UBC, and myself at Simon Fraser University, we're both knowledge mobilization managers in our institutions. We're working on a pilot initiative for early and mid-career researchers to develop the skills to integrate implementation science into their research practice. We're adapting a proven program that is offered out of Washington University currently. And so we want to adapt that for SFU and UBC. And the program's a 2-year training and mentorship program with two two summers of 1 week each in-person training, some quarterly webinar sessions in between, and most importantly, monthly mentorship meetings. There'll be details coming, but in the short run, I would really love it if I could hear from some of you about your thoughts on this idea. And Kevin's gonna put a little poll up that I did. It's two questions. So it just take us a second. First question is up. Would you be interested in participating in a implementation science institute like I just extremely briefly described? And I don't know if one of the other hosts can see if the answers are happening. I can't. So just like when it feels like maybe most people have answered, you can.
They are happening, Lupin. So we'll show you in a second. We're at 75% and it looks like we've stalled. So I'm going to go ahead and end this poll.
Perfect. Thank you. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. And there's a second question. Yeah, Kevin?
We will launch the second one now. There you go.
So what implementation science competencies would you be most interested in learning about? You can pick more than one, or you can pick all of them.
Just over 50%. Okay, we're at 80%. I'll end the poll now.
Awesome. Thanks, Kevin. Excellent. Great. Okay, so helpful. Thank you, everybody. I'm gonna say we're sort of in this meta level of we're in an implementation project in a certain way of about implementation science training. So that's great to get your feedback. A few folks in that first question were like, it depends on resources and things like that. So in the last minute, if you could throw it in the chat, if you're willing, to say what would facilitate you participating in a program like this, you know, money, time, magic, whatever it is, you could throw it in the chat as we wrap things up. Ellen, I'm assuming you probably have some last minute things to say.
Yes, with that.
Thanks.
Thank you, Lupin. Thank you to Sonia and Sarah and Lindsay for your time. And I will quickly share screen and just say, please complete the survey that will pop up when you close this window or be available by email. It does really help us direct the webinar. And if you would like to explore some of the resources that we talked about today, which will also be added to the bottom of this webinar when it's posted, please see links. And then with that, join us for our next webinar. It's happening February 24th, so only 3 weeks from now, with Dr. Shandon Peet, Understanding Indigenous Knowledge and Insider's Exercise in Delineating an Indigenous Epistemology. So very exciting. And with that, thank you to our speakers. Thank you to everyone online, and have a wonderful rest of your weekend.